sir. I need more time.
We have no time. Are you going to give that order or not?
Sir, please.
You are too naive to see the truth.
There's no bringing in Bourne.
We will defend these police officers.
Listen to police officers' commands, listen to what we tell you, and just stop. The nation needs to realize that when we tell you to do something, do it. And if you're wrong, you're wrong. If you're right, then the courts will figure it out.
We don't get to pick the laws. We enforce them. But at the end of the day, each and every member should go home safe. Sometimes the use of force is necessary. You need to comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.
Nonpartisan liberty for all. I'm your host, Dave Bourne, and it is September 13th. 2016, and we are coming to you live from Las Vegas, Nevada. Thank you for tuning in to Nonpartisan Liberty for All. We're on weeknights, Tuesday through Thursday at 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern, and you can listen live on Spreaker.com and NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com and to the archives immediately following the show on Spreaker, YouTube, Twitter, Tumblr, SoundCloud, Stitcher, and iTunes. And we are now on 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. So when you're not listening to a live show, we will be playing for now replays of older shows. I mean, I have so many shows. Jeez, I got plenty of shows to play. So don't worry about that. But while I come up with a plan as far as playing different things and stuff like that. So if you tune in, there will be something playing, although I did have an issue today due to a mistake. I understood it as a loop, which that's what they said it was, but it's not a loop. It just goes through your playlist. I thought it went through your playlist and then went back to the top and played it again, but it doesn't do that. So I have to make sure that I have enough ready to go to cover the time between my live show and the end of my live show, which is really, if I do 2 hours, it's, you know, 22 hours. But trust me, I have plenty of stuff. So we're good. And we'll look into bringing in new ideas and playing. You know, there's so many clips that I have that are important. There's documentaries that are on YouTube that I think are very important that we can play. So there's so many things, so many opportunities of what we can play when we're not doing the show. And I think that's great because there will always be something to listen to. Now, of course, you can always go listen to the archives and listen to any show you want as well. So it's, you know, like cable or DirecTV, which I have. You can go in the DVR and go watch, you know, what's on there, or you can watch what's just playing live. I don't know. To me, it's like a weird thing in my head or something. I'd rather watch something playing live than DVR. I don't know why. Don't ask why. I have no idea. I have issues. Anyway, on Nonpartisan Liberty for All, we promote self-ownership and the ideas of true freedom and liberty, meaning being able to do whatever you want as long as you respect the freedom of others and don't directly interfere with their freedom, exposing government for what it is, a mafia based on extortion that rules without consent by threat of force and violence. And we're always happy to hear from you. You can reach us via phone at 702-470-7664 or via Skype at Nonpartisan Liberty for All. And you can check us out at NonpartisanLibertyForAll.com, where we have various things, archives. We have original articles. As I had mentioned a number of times, I'm working on a series about the war on drugs and why they should go back to how they were before 1914, to be exact, and other article slash blogs as well that I've written over the time of the website that you can check out, and other things as well, pictures, stuff like that. So definitely, and all the contact information, if you forget the phone number or the Skype username or any of that, or you want to email us, it's nonpartisanlibertyforall@gmail.com, but you can find all that information there. So definitely check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. So today we're going to talk all about parents that kind of force their kids into sports. Those I watched a documentary called Trophy Kids on, I believe it was on Netflix. It's an HBO documentary. It was pretty good. So you can check that out if you have Netflix, or maybe catch it on HBO or something. And it reminded me of course, one of the guys, because he fit like all the things of Tiger Woods, except he has a girl instead of a boy. I'm sure he wanted a boy. But his daughter's half black, half Asian, just like Tiger Woods, but it's a girl, and he's trying to teach her golf. And he's trying to be like Tiger Woods' dad, who I heard was a dick because he always tried to pressure him into, you know, he made him what he was, but he did it by, you know, training him at a young age and forcing him into it and all that shit. I mean, what kid is going to pick golf? I don't know the whole story, so I don't want to say. I've heard just, you know, little bits and pieces of the Tiger Woods story, not of the one that was in the documentary. Obviously, I watched that. So I don't want to judge the father. I know he had died recently. Well, not recently, like, geez. Maybe it's been 5 years now. It's been years. And I think that's when he started fucking up. I don't know. Anyway, I don't know what kid would, well, maybe now after Tiger Woods, but before him, would want to, you know, spend all their time playing golf. I think that's why the guys were older. Most of the golfers, you know, were a lot older. It was cool playing. I played Wii Golf, and that was cool. It was kind of relaxing, and I'm the type of person that's just stressed all the time. Today's been a little stressful. Reading political stories and posts and shit like that. And I really am... Not that I like to tell people about me personally, which I kind of gave that up finally at some point, and I got more into me personally, just because if I'm going to be on the radio and I want people to listen to me and listen to me over other people, not that I feel like I'm in a competition, but I mean, people have limited time, but... Damn, my throat all of a sudden, like I feel a sore throat coming on, you know, and this is not a advertisement, but every time I've had a sore throat coming on recently, I've been using colloidal silver and the shit fucking goes away. So I got it from Alex Jones, who I really have a lot of issues with at the moment. There's still some positive things that he does, but he's a total fucking hypocrite. And I watched this video and it really fucking pissed me off too. I forget what it was about. Oh, it was about Colin Kaepernick and that whole thing. And I don't know. I don't know how, I don't understand how a guy who supposedly knows all this stuff, like way more than what we know, and how bad the government is, can still support, like, oh, we just got to get the right guy in there and Trump's the savior and all of that shit. I don't get it. I don't stand for the national anthem neither. Not for the same reasons. Well, part of the same reasons, I mean, the police, but oppression of all people, not of just this specific race, because police... kill all races, and a lot of people don't know that, but now that it's actually being tracked by an independent website, that I give more, I guess, not credit, but I give credit to them as well. But, you know, their statistics are probably as accurate as it's going to get. Plus, they provide an article with every person and the name, so you can go do more research on that person. And I've mentioned that I did like kind of a sample thing of like 80 people, but if you go there at any time every week, there's another, you know, all races that are killed and they're unarmed or they're armed with knives, or it's the same shit. Black people are killed, I think, at a higher rate, and I gotta catch my breath. Apologize for that. But I don't want to get into the whole thing about police and all that right now. That's for another time. But that it comes up a lot because people only believe what they see in government media, or they want to have their own narrative or whatever, and they just don't buy into that. No, only black people get killed by police. And no, it's not the case. But again, that doesn't mean that racism doesn't exist, and it doesn't mean that they don't get killed at a higher percentage. But, and I'll go into this a little, even though I didn't want to, because this has been kind of bothering me and stuff. It's come up today in social media, and it's been forever. I don't know how we got to this point. It's really fucked up. I really think that the media, government media, and the government, and what they orchestrated and what they've created in the past couple years, was totally created by politicians and government media, high up. I mean, the administration and government media, because I feel like people are acting like it's 1960 in terms of how black people are treated. And it's not. But that doesn't mean that there's not racism. But you have to look at things. Well, I don't want to tell anybody what they have to do. But I think in a way that when you look at things, there's a difference between, and I had talked about when I was in high school, I experienced racism because I hung around with all the black kids. So I got the, you know, you want to be, I got called white nigga, you know, stuff like that. And then later, you know, of course, black kids didn't like the fact that, like, oh, what, you trying to, you know, you think you down, whatever, and had issues with them, and not friends, but certain people, but a lot more white people than black people, to be honest. In Vegas, I've hung out at all black clubs and stuff like that, and no one's ever bothered me. I have been jumped in by all black kids in Vegas twice, and I don't know that I'd say the first time had to do with being white. I think it just had to do with an opportunity to rob me, basically, to try to rob me, was what that was. And I was drunk, way too drunk, and I put myself in a bad situation. But I don't necessarily think it was like, oh, well, you know, he's white, so we want to rob him. I don't think it had anything to do with that, to be honest. And the second time, and there's been times in Boston that I think it did have to do with being white, but the second time I know it did, because I was with a black girl and they were kind of pissed off about that and whatever. But the point is that with that is, one, not everything has to do with race. And I've said this before, just because something happens, it doesn't mean, you know, if it's between a white and black person, that it was because of race. Because you could just not like somebody. You know, there's black people I don't like because of their personality, not because they're black. I mean, one of my best friends, and all through my life, you know, my friends basically since high school, at least, my best friends have been black or Hispanic. My fiance is Hispanic, but I've dated, you know, I'll date white girls. I've dated white girls, and I find white girls beautiful as well. It's all in the person. And, you know, I've dated black girls also right before my ex-girlfriend. But that wasn't – she actually asked me about that recently. That wasn't serious. But there was one girl that was – she was part black, but she was mostly Indian. But, I mean, like, she looked black. So what's the difference? that I was pretty serious with. The point is it's whatever. It doesn't matter. It's all about, you know, I find beauty in every type of girl. But I think if I had to pick one type, like, Mexican and Hispanic girls are probably the most, you know, my type, I guess, if I had to be honest. So, but it doesn't mean that I, you know, I don't discriminate, whatever, but I'm engaged. So, I will be getting married at some point. But my point being is that, you know, you can look at a situation and you have people now that will look at everything in color. That if something happens between a white person and a black person, a white person fires a black person, or they get in a fight, or whatever, that it was because of their race. Usually the white person will get blamed, but the black person could get blamed too. It's gotten to that point with some people, and it's pretty ridiculous because not, you know, it's to the point now I was thinking, like, a white person could be looking at a black girl, you know, staring at her or something because he thinks she's attractive, and she could interpret that as racism, like, oh, he was staring at me, like, why am I here or something, like, I don't know. I was just thinking of something like that, as innocent as, you know, staring at a girl. I'm sure not every girl, you know, but some girls could construe that as racism. I know the YouTube has gotten, with millennials, gotten out of fucking control. And I don't mean that in any sense that everybody has their right to express what they want. Just like I'm on here expressing what I want and doing a show about what I want. So maybe I shouldn't use the word out of control. But some of the stuff that I've listened to and heard, and for the, you got both sides. For every black person that has one side, there's probably, you know, the same amount of black people that take the other side of an issue. There really is. But there's there's just one girl, and I mean, she gets thousands, up in the 10,000s, has like 14,000 subscribers. And you know, basically, if she was saying that if black people don't have jobs, it's because of white people won't give them jobs and white people control every. It was almost demeaning to black people in a way. And then she was demeaning any black men that date white women because they should know better, because white women always claim rape or domestic violence. and white women are evil and black men should know better than to date white women. And it just this is all shit that I don't even want to get into. And it, really, I don't have to, because it has nothing to do with freedom. It's people just running their fucking mouths, to be honest. And they have their right to, you know, if that's how they feel. But then for every girl, like, then on the other side, you have this girl who promotes interracial dating. So, like, she has a whole channel where she talks about black girls that date white guys. So it's like, you know, for every one side, you have somebody on the other side of it, you know. And then I've been going through trying to just, you know, I'm at work all day and I try to find something long on YouTube that I can listen to while I'm working. And it's just I'm looking for more and more stuff, because radio stations I can't get. It blocks any streaming shit. My work blocks it. So YouTube, it doesn't block, which is cool. But, you know, so I'll go through and I want to find ideas for shows and I want to know what's going on. But then, like, I kind of don't when I hear shit like that. And I'm like, this woman is just hateful. You know what I'm saying? I mean, if she feels that way, she feels that way. And if it was a white woman, you know, trust me, you got what's his name, who's totally like a white nationalist now. It might as well join the Nazi party. Cantwell, the Chris Cantwell guy, who actually came on my show years ago, who was great on the show. And then all of a sudden he's, you know, like a white nationalist. I'm like, what the fuck? You know, and just openly calls people nigga and stuff. I'm like, what the fuck is going on with this motherfucker? And he claims he's not racist, though. So that, I would say, you know, what he does is definitely racist. I'm sorry. And I'm not one to throw the word racist around, because I think people throw it around like it's nothing. And that's the whole point. Like, things have gotten so much better now. It's hard for me to see, because I kind of isolate myself, to be honest. Even at work, I have a job where, you know, I can go a whole day without talking to anybody. So how am I, you know, my exposure to people is limited, like society, I guess, or what's going on, you know. I guess I get everything from the internet. And it's not like when I was in high school, I could see, you know, what's the climate in high schools, because I don't know what the climate in high schools is like right now, or in Las Vegas, where I had lived right outside of Boston, and there was a lot of racism. So, you know, I don't know, but I do know, I know enough, you know, from at least my experiences prior to maybe the past 5 years, you know, when I used to go out a lot. And, well, I've still, when I was gambling, I was going out. And so but that I kind of kept to myself too. But before that, you know, when I used to go out to bars a lot and clubs a lot and stuff like that. And like I said, I used to go to this, it was a hip hop club that it was, but it was in an area where it was all black and nobody bothered me or anything. Everybody was cool. And I was like, you know, the only white person there, you know, was there with my friends, whatever, that were black. But this whole thing that it's like worse than it was, you know, 50 years ago or something, or 60 years ago, it's just not the case. And, oh, this is what I was going to get into, and I fucking almost wasted a half hour on this fucking bullshit. But there's a difference, okay? When you have people getting killed and hung and no one going to jail for it, or just whether they go to jail for it or not, I mean, even if they do go to jail for it, and things like that happening compared to people just not liking a certain race but not saying anything about it, or just keeping to just hanging around with a certain race. You know, there's a big difference. Like, now it's more opinions or words or that type of thing, if anything, or internally people have hate. And people are free to believe what they want and think what they want and express what they want. Now, when you express things on the air or in a forum where multiple people can listen to that, obviously you have the freedom to do that, but there's consequences. There can be consequences in that people might not want to listen to you or associate with you or whatever, but that's up to them and that's free association. But on the other side, you have people that think, well, just because there's a black president, like, okay, everything's fine now. There's a black president. And that's not true neither. So, you know, the thing with police is, yes, more black people are getting killed by police than white people. But this is something that just has been going on forever. And it's like the media orchestrated it in a way with the Mike Brown case, which was a case that the facts were disputed, that it was a case that you could throw out there and it's going to start a big fight between people. You know it right away. That's a case based on this person saying this and then this person saying this and whatever, that there's going to be separation on that case. And when you have videos of people just getting murdered by police that are just clear cut, that you can't really argue, they didn't show those. But they should. Well, they did show Eric Garner, so, but not until they kind of minimized that at the time. It was really, you know, And even with Trayvon Martin as well, and how the media orchestrated that, where they showed the picture of him being 12 years old and made people that didn't pay a lot of attention to the news, if you just caught it quick, you'd think, oh, this guy killed a little 12-year-old. And it's like, what the fuck? That's what my fiance had thought, that he killed a 12-year-old. I was like, no, he killed a 17-year-old. It was like 6'2". Not that that's okay, but I'm just saying that there were things that were purposely left out, like NBC edited the call. And so I feel like it's almost like it's not real. I mean, if you go back to, say, 2013, now the positive thing about it is more people know about police killing people. But it didn't have to be done in the way they did it to manipulate and to push across a narrative to, I mean, their goal, one of them, the government's, is to federalize the police. So it turned into that. And they're totally exploiting it now. And I did a show on, you know, Black Lives Matter is basically run by these billionaires that put the money into it. And that platform has to do with things that progressives want, like global warming is in there. And what was the other thing? Everyone has to go to public school. There was something else, too, that's in the progressives' agenda. There's a bunch of shit. And it's like they totally exploited it. And to me, it's the government, because it's government media that did it. And they instructed them, you know, report on this like this and whatever. And if you don't think that the government controls the majority of media, then you're, you know, naive. But, and they have since movies silent movies. The FBI or CIA had an office in the well, not CIA because they weren't around yet. The FBI, and I had the document because there was a show I did where I went through all these documents that people of stuff that people might not know, and that was or it was on the one where, sorry, I've done so many shows where I just talked about media. It might have been that one, and that was one of them where I had the document. You know, I got it from the internet. It was a declassified document. But I don't know. It's just things are being controlled and too many people are falling into it, I think. And it's just dividing people when the government really is just gonna make us all slaves, essentially. I mean, already, if you pay taxes, I mean, what do you think that is? You're working for the government, man. You're already in their system. So there's other things I could say. I don't even want to talk about this anymore, to be honest, because I'm for the freedom of all people, no matter what the issue or no matter what race is being oppressed by the issue. If there's an issue that is oppressing the freedom of somebody, then, you know, that's something that I'm going to address. And I believe in what I call true freedom and liberty. So a lot of people are even getting brainwashed on what that means because they're being taught positive freedoms, like, I have the right to not get shot, so ban guns. I have the right to health care, so, you know, force doctors to, because really you're forcing somebody to do something for you, and that's not freedom because you're affecting their freedom. And that's why I even say in my paragraph at the beginning of the show that, you know, you're affecting somebody else's. It's about doing whatever you want, as long as you don't directly, and I say directly because, you know, your family could say you're affecting their freedom because you're upsetting them. Well, that's not affecting their freedom. It's directly affecting somebody else's freedom. So if you're forcing somebody to do something, you're affecting their freedom. So anything that directly forces somebody to do something for you has nothing to do with freedom. Nothing. Despite what people might tell you. But anyway, I'm, again, out there to talk about true freedom and liberty and to promote those ideas. Because I think that when people really understand it, I think a lot of people don't understand it. I think people associate it with conservatives, which is bad, especially the word liberty. And it hasn't, and conservatives aren't about freedom and liberty. And, you know, they associate it with rich people and stuff like that. It's really just about making your own choices for your own life and not having a government interfering with it, period. You know, and people don't think of, they automatically think they'll take something that happened in the past and say, well, what if the government wasn't there? Not realizing that if the government wasn't there, there'd be an opening for an opportunity where there would be something else. And I mean that in the sense that if, just like products, man, if there's a demand, it's going to be met by a supply. And it's the same thing. But if you're basing things on how they are now and assuming that all of these things were the same, and not thinking outside the box, then you'll automatically, well, then this would have happened. They wouldn't have been there for this, and this would have happened. That's not necessarily the case. You don't know what the case is. And if you don't think outside the box, then you definitely don't have a vision of what things could be. So I just try to advise people to keep an open mind. Of course, people can think whatever they want and think I'm full of shit and whatever. But you can't base things like if when I talk about having an organized society with no government, you can't take everything how it is now and then say, well, what about this? Because there are things that are how they are now because of other things. So, like, because there's this, then there has to be this type thing. But if this wasn't there, then you wouldn't need this. You'd have this instead. And I'm just trying to give a hypothetical how everything kind of trickles down and affects something else. So that's kind of how it works. And to think about it in a, you know, with those blinders on, to be in that paradigm of how the government currently is, you'll never get out of that. You have to totally think outside the box and really recognize things for what they are. I don't know. So anyway, I want to get to our main topic for tonight. And one of the reasons why I want to talk about this, because it gives me the opportunity to talk more about peaceful parenting. And I like to promote that because I think it's one of the most important things, along with drugs being legalized, or not legalized, but just the government just totally fucking staying out of it. And the, you know, getting rid of police, to having true freedom and liberty, or at least getting some of it back. And this would be for future generations, obviously. So when you think about future generations right now, we're fucked, because between video games and TV and school and all of those things, they're all designed to lead somebody to believe that the way the government is how things should be. And it, think about, like, why people 100 years ago thought of something as no big deal, and today people think of, oh my God, that's crazy. Like, heroin. Just comes to mind. Or drinking and driving. I mean, that's not even that long ago that it wasn't considered a huge thing. So you think of things like that. How do you think it got to where everybody changed their opinion like that? Well, a lot of propaganda. And people could say, well, because it's the right thing, and people finally discovered. Well, why didn't they figure that out? Like, say for alcohol. Alcohol and cars were around for years until they started with the strict drinking and driving laws and the checkpoints, which they just came up with checkpoints because the police wanted a way to, you know, it had nothing to do with drinking and driving. They just wanted to search people. They had all that time, and then finally they thought of that? No. Something happened, there was an incident, and, you know, Mothers Against Drunk Driving or some group got together and lobbied. And then after that, they, you know, propaganda. They kept hitting people with this, and this is how it is, and this is whatever. It's just like letting people under 21 drink. If you lived in Europe, you wouldn't think it was a big deal. Now, why is that? Well, it's because you grew up in a society where they pounded into your head that it's bad unless you're 21. It's fucking stupid. Because it's the law, and breaking laws is bad, because somehow people also got it in their head that laws and morals are the same thing, but they're not the same thing. They have nothing to do with each other, actually. They're almost the opposite in a lot of ways. So when it comes to kids, I mean, if things continue the way they are, we're fucked. But you can obviously change the way you parent your kids. Or not necessarily you change, but when you have kids, change compared to how your parents did it, or generations before you did it. So these parents that are these coaches that essentially push their kids into sports, I guess there's a couple kinds of parents when it comes to sports. So you have like the raving lunatic fan parent that, you know, is sitting at the game, screaming at the referee, making a big spectacle of themselves and doing all that. It's not that bad, but it's probably embarrassing for the kid and, you know, you should stop. But in that scenario, you may or may not have pushed your kid into the sport in the first place. And a lot of those parents don't necessarily push their kids into sports. I know I was only good at one sport that I played, and it was football. And I should have kept playing, but it was only Pop Warner. So it's not like it means I would have went anywhere. But my parents... My mom, especially, she got into football over that, and she loved watching me play, but she didn't get me to play football. And even when I played 1 year that I was really good and they wanted me to come back the next year, and I quit like a dumbass, and they were trying to get me to come back. And my father, you know, talked to them. And talked to me and said, if you want to come back, you know, they want you to come back, because it was later in the season didn't start yet, but it was late, it, you know, practices and stuff had already started. And they were going to make an exception for me. And my dad was the one who they were, you know, talking to. And I almost did come back, but he didn't, you know, force me or anything like that. It was like, hey, if you want to play, then play. If you don't, you know, then don't. He's like, I love watching you play, but if you don't want to play, then that's fine. Not that my father was a good father or the greatest father or anything, but with that specific thing, you know, with sports, it wasn't a push you into sports thing. It basically was only if you sign up for the season and I have to pay for it, then you have to play the whole season. That was really it. It was like, okay, you know, this costs money. Cause that was before, high school is when I played, you know, when you play in like the town leagues or your local area, and there's a bunch of teams and they just play each other. Well, that was for basketball. I think basketball was all the same town, and football, we played other towns and we traveled not that far. I mean, probably the furthest we traveled was like 45 minutes or something. So we had like a bus or whatever. For the basketball games, it'd just be the same place and it would be all the same area. So, and baseball too was the same thing. But it would be different, you know, fields we play at, but they'd all be in the same town. So with that, it was just, okay, if I'm going to have to pay, you know, $50 or $25 or $100 or whatever it was. I know football was the most expensive because, you know, the helmet and all the equipment and stuff that you don't buy, but, I mean, they obviously have to buy, so you pay, you know, more money to play that sport because they have to pay more money. And I would think they're a nonprofit and the coaches volunteer, but they just need money for, you know, probably the buses and the equipment and whatnot. So it might have been $100. But it was just, if you're going to play, that's fine. You know, you made a commitment, just fulfill your commitment. So that was the only thing really with him in sports with me. I was never forced into playing sports or anything like that. But you have these parents that have these fantasies of like kind of vicariously living through their kids. So you have the sideline parents, whatever. Then you have well, I wouldn't call them the sideline parents, just the fans, that they're just fans, but they go a little too far. And maybe they'll talk to the coach and be like, well, why don't you put my son here? They're a little too involved. You know, going to the game and just clapping when there's good plays for your son's or daughter's team is fine. You know, you can kind of leave it at that. But talking to the coach or yelling at the referee or, you know, kind of getting into that is not that bad, but you're borderline, I think, at that point. So then you have the kind of parent trainers or part coaches, I guess. These aren't the parents that coach the team. That's why I don't want to call them parent coaches, but they coach individually, like outside of the team sport, meaning when they're not playing a game or they're not practicing with the team, they're giving them certain exercises to do, or they're out in the backyard practicing or doing all that. So in this video, they kind of had all kinds of parents, really. But they were all ones that were at least at that level. So you had, for example, this basketball guy where he said, you know, I owned like 7 businesses. I quit them all just to, I shouldn't say basketball guy. It was a kid who played basketball, but father whose son played basketball. And he, you know, said he had all these jobs and he quit them since his son was like 7 or something. Like, they started early. And that, you don't know shit, because you don't know, especially with a sport like basketball. You know, baseball, height and really body type don't necessarily matter, because if you can hit the fucking ball, I mean, if you can always, you know, put on weight or whatever, but if you can hit the ball, that's what really matters. But something like football or basketball, where it's just about being tall. But the taller you get, I mean, if you notice, like, guys that are like 7 feet tall, you know, are awkward. They can't like dribble the ball that well down the court or whatever. You know, there are some, like Magic Johnson was 6'9" and he could handle the ball. Like, you know, he was a point guard. But that usually doesn't happen. So anyway, he put all his time into it. He started training them, vitamins and all this shit, and spent all this money. And he would, you know, sit on the sidelines and, of course, you know, yell at the ref and yell at his son, which was kind of embarrassing, you know, to take more shots or do this or do that. And I don't remember. I know his son didn't end up doing that well. I don't think it got to the point where, and it may have, and I forgot, but they were ready to go to college, because the whole thing was, okay, get a Division I scholarship. But I don't think he was good enough to even go that far. and you have this father kind of putting all this time in. And I couldn't tell if the kid wanted to do it or not. And when you're little, when you're seven, I mean, do you really know if... See, I would be the other way, where if your kid comes to you and says they want to play a sport, or you can ask them, do you want to play a sport? Because kids constantly want to please their parents. And even if they think that you want them to do something, they might do it just to make you happy, especially when they're younger. And of course, as they get older, they don't give a fuck what you think. I just know that from being a kid, not being a parent, because I don't have any kids. So there's got to be, though, if you start young, that pressure that you don't want to disappoint them because you've done it for so long, you know, and that I'm sure becomes a factor as well. So it's like, you know, are you doing this for you, or are you doing this for them? And obviously, it seemed like the father was doing it for him, but the way they portrayed him is he wasn't as bad as these two other fathers. So I think in the show there were four fathers. I know there were two basketball fathers. There was a football, a golf, and then there was a mother who had twins that wanted them to be tennis players. And, you know, she was pretty bad. But the two worst was the one who wanted to be like Tiger Woods' father with his daughter. And he had two daughters, and I don't know if he planned on doing the same thing with his other daughter, who is younger. But, I mean, he took his daughter to a tournament. I mean, he's going over to the side like, motherfucking bitch and whatever. I mean, the girl's like 7 years old, and he has every book, like Tiger Woods' father, the book he wrote, and how to make your turn your kid into a, you know, pro athlete or something like that. And that's like his whole goal in life is, okay, I'm going to take my kid and make them a pro golf star. And at the end, I think she had won a tournament, but I mean, she was really young, so you don't know what was going to happen. But that was totally, you could tell that he got her into golf. He would tell her to shut up when they were walking too. They were walking, or they didn't have a golf cart or something, or they did, but he was walking and she was in the golf cart. I don't remember. And he would just tell her to shut up. But it was all him. It was he. And like I said, I mean, it was just like Tiger Woods, except the girl version, because his father was black and his mother was Asian, and the same thing. And he's like, okay, she can be the next, you know, female Tiger Woods. I don't even know if there's is there a PGA tournament for girls, and are they able to just enter the men's, or do they have a woman's? I don't know. I don't know that much about golf. I know tennis, you know, they have both, but I don't think they do in golf. I could be wrong, but I don't believe they do. So I guess he wanted her to become be on the men's circuit. I think there was a woman that played in on the men's circuit. I think if you're good enough, but I would think it's harder for women in general to have the strength to drive the ball as far as a man. It's just a genetic thing. And that whole thing too, political fucking correctness, man, is just whatever. I don't give a fuck. I'm going to say whatever I want to say. I don't want to hurt anybody's feelings because that's not what I'm about. But, I mean, things are ridiculous. And I know at some point it's going to get to a hate speech scenario. They already kind of done it on the internet to an extent. I mean, they're suspending people's accounts. YouTube is not monetizing people. It's pretty fucked up, actually. I have some of my stuff not monetized because anything that had to do with drugs. And I had the show I did on Kratom that DEA was schedule wanting it. And at first they let me monetize it, and then they didn't. They took it off. And that one, I've gotten like the most listens through YouTube because I haven't been on YouTube that long, and I don't get a lot of listens on YouTube in general. Like, you know, I get like 20 or something, if that. And it's at like, it keeps going up. It's at like 700 or something. And so, of course, the one that is the, that has the most is they won't monetize it. So I'll have to appeal that or see if I can. Because there's nothing, I mean, because I'm talking about, first of all, it's legal and it's becoming illegal, but I'm not like promoting it. It's more informational. It's not a everybody go out and, I mean, I guess I talk about what it does and how it's fucked up that they're schedule wanting it. But I mean, what's wrong with that? I don't know. Anyway, so that father was really fucked up. And you had another father who his son went to live. I felt bad for this kid because he lived with his mom, and the father, of course, says to the mom that she's not hard on him enough. And this guy, you know, of course, wants to control everything and the discipline shit and all the shit that I'm against. Because you're training your kid to be obedient, not question authority, and hand them off to the government, of course. And that's the whole fucking problem, is that you bring up your kids, disciplining them all the time. A lot of time, you know, because I said so. I would hear that all the time. Why? Because I said so. Now, luckily for me, I was just the type of person to question shit and look at things and say, you know, this is not right. This is wrong. This is not okay. That type of thing. And from that, I became the person I am. Not to say I like everything about me, but as far as the standing up for myself and standing up to government and those type of things, you know, recognizing injustices. Because I stood up as a kid, always. I stood up, started with standing up to my father, standing up in school, standing up to bullies. And I remember in fifth or sixth grade. So I was shy and quiet, but if something happened, I would stand up for myself. And, you know, at first I got beat up a lot, so that kind of sucked. By my father as well. But not a lot of people are like that, that just have that. It's like I was born with that. It's in my DNA or something, to question things, to think for myself, to recognize injustices or when I feel like something is wrong and do something about it. And nowadays, I mean, there are some people like that, but I think it's even harder because when I was growing up, yeah, all the same brainwashing went on, but I don't think it was to the extent that it is now. I mean, every generation, it just keeps getting worse. So now they have, you know, Common Core and everything. But these parents are extremes of obedience, really. So this kid, he had lived with his mother. He went to live with his father. And his father was coaching him on football. And he was treating him like he's an idiot. If he got something wrong or didn't do it the way that the father wanted, he'd start yelling at him and call him an idiot and say, "What are you, you know, what are you fucking stupid?" And all of these things. And then the kid, he was talking to the kid when they went to visit the mom, and he said, you know, the kid who was 14 said, "I don't want to talk about this now." And the dad's like, "What?" He's like, "I say when we stop talking about shit." He was like that type of fucking, you know, I don't know. Maybe he had his own fucking issues with his parents. And he's like, "Oh, now I get to control somebody." And you think about why people have kids in the first place, man. And maybe his dreams were he wanted to be a professional football player. And he's you know, he thinks he's helping his son and trying to live through him. But, you know, he'd watch the games. He'd be on the sideline. And then, of course, after he'd critique and – well, he wouldn't critique because that would be a nice way to do it. He'd, you know, "Why didn't you do this?" And that was dumb. And you should have asked the coach when he took you out why he took you out. And you should have done this. And – you know, it was an edited, of course, documentary and that was trying to get a point across. I mean, there was already an agenda in the documentary that these parents are fucked up. And, you know, we know parents like this exist because people have probably met them before. And I remember growing up, the kids that had the fathers like that. So it's not like they don't exist. Or they're portraying something that isn't real, because it is. But, you know, there could have been some good parts. I don't know. But this guy was just, there was enough, I guess, that they showed of him just being an ass that it wouldn't have mattered. So at the end, it actually says that he went back to live with his mom and he's playing football there. And he doesn't really talk to his dad anymore. And that's sad that he doesn't talk to him anymore. But look what he did. So he ended up, and this is what happens too. People don't realize is he just ended up pushing his kid away by being an asshole. So now he barely has a relationship with his son because he's a dick. That's all he did. So how does that help anything? And when you, this, it has nothing to do with that story, but everybody knows in general, when you tell somebody not to do something or you try to stop them from doing something, what are they going to do? They're going to do it. And you know, especially teenagers. And I still don't get why parents haven't figured this fucking shit out and why they just don't let their kids, for the most part, do what they want to do, but talk to them about it if it's something they can do at home. Like, if they're going to go out to a party and drink, why not let your kids have a party at your house and fucking let them drink? Now, I know you might be scared. Most states, you can let your kids drink in your house. I'm not sure about other people's kids. And that's where I understand if you're like, fuck, I could get in trouble. And that's what I'm worried about, you know, their kids. So that I totally understand. But and I'm just using this as an example. Even sex. If your kid wants to have sex, and especially girls, because guys, it's not as... you know, taboo or looked upon as badly. And I guess it depends, too, if you have a father, you know, in the house or not. But assuming you do. But so your kid and a lot of parents, not a lot, but I've seen documentaries where parents have actually realized this and have started doing it. And I always did it. But at first, I don't think my father wanted me to, but then he didn't say anything. I don't know. At first, he kind of acted like he did, like he went in and checked on me, like what was I about to do? And then he just let it go and said, fuck it, you know, because it's literally, I guess he said, fuck it. but would you rather your kids have sex in your house where you know they're safe? I mean, you know, safe at least from getting into any trouble like the police or, you know, getting raped or something like that. And I mean that in a sense of like, you know, somebody else seeing them having sex and coming over like an adult or something. I don't know. And talking to them about it and, you know, if they're going to have sex, give them fucking condoms, birth control, whatever. But isn't it better to do that than for them to go out and have sex in the car or someplace else or somebody's house or, you know, have them going around finding a place that might not be the best place to go? And, you know, things like that. I think, and I've talked about this before, I don't know when it comes to younger kids, when you allow them, I'm not sex, but to have more freedom. You know, I try to think about when I was younger, and I know at very young, you know what the fuck is going on. So I guess it all depends. But once you're 13, 14, for most kids, I mean, there are some kids that aren't that mature. But, you know, once you're 13, 14, I mean, people used to get married at 13 and 14, you know, 200 years ago or 300 years ago. Maybe more than that, maybe like 1,000, but it's because they died at like 30. But still, I think that this whole idea of being an overbearing parent and telling your kid what to do and disciplining them when they're in high school is ridiculous. I think being and people don't. The same way people don't understand the concept of getting rid of the police and replacing them with people that actually keep you safe and protect you, they just automatically think, oh, it would be total chaos. They don't understand this neither. But the concept really is from a very young age, as soon as I guess your kid can, you can talk to them, you are more involved than most parents would be, but you're not telling them what to do. You're helping to shape their values and telling them about life and how to act in different situations. And you're not telling them, like, you have to do this or you have to do that. You're giving them information. And then hopefully, you know, by the time they're 14 and 15, you're still involved. And hopefully, because you weren't a parent telling them what to do and being overbearing, but were still there for them, they will come to you and trust you and tell you everything. And, you know, at the same time, then you bring up a kid who has a mind to question things and not just obey blindly. And when they turn 18 and get handed over to the government, really, I mean, they're still under the government. It's really bad for kids, man, between parents. I mean, think of it, too. It's bad enough that look at fucking schools and you have police in schools and all the rules in schools. I feel really bad for kids that have to go to government schools, even private schools, but especially government schools. I mean, they're in a prison. Then they have to deal with the rules of their parents and they have to deal with the rules of the school and the police, i.e. government. So, you know, a parent piling more onto that is bad. Now, of course, I wouldn't send a kid to government school. I think that's insane, especially with the climate now of, you know, arrests taking place in school over ridiculous fucking shit. So you have a, you know, I don't understand how people can, two things, and this kind of goes back to what I said at the beginning, although I don't want to focus too much on this, but to say that all people aren't oppressed by the government is very, you can look at it two ways. You're either stupid or you're just in denial, because the one you could eliminate that idea with one thing, and that's spying. The government spying and collecting everybody's data. If that's not oppression, then I don't know what is. That, along with the fact that every police department has militarized, whether it's an all-white suburban neighborhood or the projects in a ghetto. So those are two things that all people are being, you know, two ways, and there's a lot more, are being oppressed. And I say that because at the beginning, I was kind of talking about, you know, police and how they are killing all races, although black people at a higher rate and whatnot, and some of those things. But it's like there are some people that will say, well, only black people are being oppressed and white people have it, you know, a job knocks on your door or something and you just get everything handed to you. And there are some people like that, the elite that run everything, but the majority of people are not in that boat. So on that note, we're going to take a break. When we come back, I will talk more about the parent coaches. We'll talk about the tennis mother, and she was kind of all over the place, as well as the other people I've mentioned, and just the concepts in general, and maybe look at how you can have a kid in sports and how you should deal with it, along with how you probably, well, I don't want to say again how you should, or I'm not here to tell anybody what to do. I always correct myself when I say that. Everything is my opinion. You can take it and throw it away, or you can take some of it, or you can follow all of it. But I don't want to tell people what they should or should not do. I'm here to promote the ideas of true freedom and liberty for everybody, and to try to express those ideas, and some days are better than others at doing it, express those ideas in a way that people can understand and try to keep people open-minded to them. Because things have gone so far. You know, a lot of the things that I say 100 years ago, I either wouldn't have to say them because it wouldn't be the case, like drugs, or they wouldn't be a big deal if I did. Now, you have the other side of it where parents were probably a lot stricter and things like that. Or at least we think that. But where do we get that information from? I guess more history from talking to grandparents. I don't know that. I think they were strict in a different way, but they definitely, discipline was a big thing in schools and I think with parents. And I'm telling people the opposite. I'm saying don't discipline your kids. And for people to hear that, I understand if somebody hearing that and being like, you're fucking nuts. How can you not discipline your kids? Or just like, how can you not have police? Or how can you not have a government? Or how can you not have this or that? So I understand, especially something like that. But there's a difference between just dismissing something and having an open mind and at least listening. Okay, well, you know, I disagree with that. And then there's also, and I was thinking of this morning, and then we'll take a break and play some clips. Just because, and I've had this happen, you know, there may be some ideas that I have that you totally fucking disagree with that may even piss you off. Hopefully not. But there may be some ideas that I have that you just don't like at all. They piss you off, whatever, for whatever reason. Now, I don't think there's anything offensive that I say that people should be offended. Although, you know, when it comes to the police and the military, they might be. But all I ask people, I guess, is to just be open-minded. And if you disagree, then you disagree. And if you disagree with a few things, why should you just, even if it's something that you really disagree with strongly, why should you just dismiss everything else and say, well, fuck him then, because he thinks this way on this, even though I agree with him on all this other stuff, fuck him, I'm not going to listen to him anymore, or he's an idiot or whatever. And I don't know how many returned listeners I have and how many people listen to the show on a regular basis, or it's just a lot of new people and they don't like it and then they don't listen again. I mean, I would assume there would have to be some return people. Otherwise, my stats would drop significantly. Or there could be a lot of people that are just getting the download and not listening to it, that they subscribe to the feed, I guess. I'm not sure how it counts that, though, if they have to open it or not. Anyway, so I ask that people be open-minded, whether they, you know, I don't expect everybody to agree with me on everything. Of course, the more people agree with me as a whole, and I don't mean the more people, like counting people, but an individual person agrees with me, of course, the better. But I don't expect people to agree with me on everything. I just ask that, you know, you stay open-minded and don't dismiss everything I say just because you don't agree with a few things I say, or, you know, 20% of what I say or something like that. So, and I have that issue, to be honest. Some people, I guess I have a threshold of if somebody gets to a certain point when it comes to radio, how far I'll go. And right now I don't listen to anybody really. Even Free Talk Live, because Mark's barely on, and I just don't really. It's kind of I don't have the time, because usually if I'm listening, you know, the stuff I'm listening to all day, I'm trying to listen to stuff to prepare for a show. You know, while I'm working, I'm listening to stuff that relates to the show that I'm doing. So, I mean, that's another reason why. But I used to listen to it every day. And I still recommend it to people. So, and I saw Mark the last time he was here. If you don't know what I'm talking about, Free Talk Live, Mark Edge is one of the co-hosts. I think he said he only does Wednesdays and Saturdays now anyway. So, but we're going to take a break. I have some clips regarding parents in sports. One, I think, broke out in a fight between parents. I mean, this is the type of shit that's happening. Like, parents are fighting and shit from opposite teams, maybe even the same team, because they're like, play my kid, and they're playing another kid, and it's some serious shit, man. There's actually, I started watching it, but I'm like, it's kind of boring. I don't want to watch a bunch of kids, but there's Friday Night Tykes is on Netflix. It's like a series, I think it is in Texas, with you know, youth football, but I think the kids were like 8 or 9, and I'm like, yeah, I turned it on and I'm like, I really don't want to watch this. But it might be interesting to people who have kids and sports and stuff. But that's on YouTube. Yeah, YouTube. On Netflix, Friday Night Tykes with the takeoff, and, you know, Friday Night Lights, which was actually, I kind of like that movie, but you know how they're crazy over there about their sports, even high school. So, but we'll be right back. Every Monday night, be sure to tune in to the Illumination Hour with Ellen Stallone, 7 o'clock Pacific, 10 o'clock Eastern. And make sure you check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. And we'll be right back.
You know, the positive lessons that youngsters learn on the fields of sport have been well documented. In youth leagues nationwide, kids are learning all about sportsmanship, perspective, and discipline, the very attributes that many of their parents now seem to be lacking when they watch them play. What's worse is that many of those soccer moms and little league dads who have long been loudmouths at children's games have now added a new and violent dimension to their ways. In this Real Sports Sports Illustrated report, our Bernie Goldberg looks at the dirty sports secret of America's suburbs.
He broke my nose, broke it right across the bridge. The septum was deviated 40%, and he fractured my left orbital right underneath the eye.
Steve Farinacci was mugged, but not in some dark alley by some stranger late at night. Farinacci is a soccer referee in Port St. Lucie, Florida, who was attacked in broad daylight by a coach.
5 minutes into the second half, I call a foul against the Port St. Lucie team. The coach came up off the bench, slammed his clipboard down, and proceeded to start yelling at me.
But that was just the beginning. Farinacci says the coach kept up the tirade and even started cursing at him. Fed up with the verbal abuse, especially in the presence of kids, Farinacci called off the game and started walking off the field.
I'm approaching the clubhouse when he says, "You said you couldn't talk to me out on the field. Will you talk to me now?" And I'm right here. And I turn, and you can see I turn, and I said, "Sure." He's approaching me rapidly. When he does that, he bumps into me. I mean, with the force. I mean, he's a big guy. Backs me up into the door like this, and I knew I was in trouble. You can see he proceeds just to slam down on my head, and I just stumble into the clubhouse.
And this camera right here?
Yes, caught it.
A surveillance camera right outside the clubhouse caught the whole thing. The coach, Maurice Lesmus, confronts Farinacci and headbutts him. Lesmus, who refused to do an interview with Real Sports, pled no contest to battery, was sentenced to 7 days in jail, and given 1 year probation.
This is part of what the experts tell us is a growing trend.
Yes, it is definitely growing. The insults have gotten more personal, and more violent in nature.
The fact is, in parks all across America, the field of dreams has become a field of screams. Fights, if not commonplace, well, they're certainly no longer unusual. And what makes it really crazy is that, for the most part, it's not the kids who are starting the mayhem. The real troublemakers, the ones who can't seem to control themselves, are the coaches and the parents, the ones we like to call the grown-ups.
Last October, a coach in Nebraska punches a 16-year-old referee during a flag football game involving 6 and 7-year-olds. A month later, a post-game handshake in Weston, Florida, turns into a brawl between parents, coaches, and teenage football players.
The police are on the way. Get off the field.
This past summer in Hollywood, Florida, a coach turns himself in after being charged with assault for allegedly breaking an umpire's jaw at a teen baseball game. And then in July, outside Boston, what begins as a shoving match between two fathers after a kid's hockey practice ends with one beaten to death, the other charged with manslaughter and facing 20 years in prison.
How do you describe what's going on out there?
Insanity, craziness, loss of perspective of parents across this country with their children in sports.
20 years ago, Fred Eng started the National Alliance for Youth Sports, an organization that monitors children's athletics. The game is for kids, he says, not for a bunch of obnoxious adults.
Obviously, most parents, the overwhelming majority, are wonderful people. Let me preface that. But the ugly people are growing and growing. That's why this has to stop.
But why has it gotten so nasty? What makes some parents so angry over a game that, in the big scheme of things, is so meaningless?
Three different things: fear, ego, and greed. As a parent, I have a tremendous fear today, more than ever, that my child would not be number one.
Ego?
Ego, it's not going to happen the second time around. I didn't make my little league team, didn't make the high school team, didn't make the I could have been a major league player.
They're living through their kids?
Absolutely. And you know the ugly part of the third thing?
Greed?
Greed, you got it. My child's going to make some of that big money. Scholarship money, going to get into the major leagues, million-dollar contracts, and that's where it crosses over the line. See, the parents are the ones that put up the scoreboards, the standings, the championships, the all-star games. Kids, you ask kids if they want that? Nah. What kids want is fun.
Eng cites a Michigan State University survey that says of the 20 million kids who participate in youth sports in America, 70% of them quit before they turn 13.
What was the number one reason that they gave for dropping out?
Boys and girls alike, the number one reason, it ceased to be fun.
Sports ceased to be fun.
What are they telling us?
What do you think they're telling us?
They're telling us to back off. Let us have fun. Give it back to us. Behave.
You're making it sound like kids are more grown up than the grown-ups.
Well.
Which brings us to Miami, just before Labor Day of this year. Two coaches fight it out over an umpire's call at a t-ball game for 4 and 5-year-olds. Peter Hernandez is a parent of one of the t-ball players, as well as one of the coaches involved.
I took a swing. He hit me back, you know, and that's where everyone else went out. And as other parents are trying to stop other people, another fight broke out, and, you know, it just got into a really big brawl.
A very big brawl? You could say that. Take a look. Parents in the stand see the coaches fighting, so they storm onto the field and begin battling each other as their kids watch.
They get too much into the game, and they want to win, and they want to win.
Giancarlo Peluso is the 16-year-old umpire who made the call that touched off the fight.
The fight was like between 20 minutes. The coaches started it, and then it ended up girls and then like mothers fighting each other and screaming names at each other and running at each other, everything.
The mothers are hitting each other?
The fathers, brothers, sisters, everyone was fighting.
No grandmothers?
No grandmothers.
Both of the coaches have been suspended from the league. As for Hernandez, who says he was just defending himself, does he regret getting involved in the scuffle that touched off the brawl?
I've had time to think about it, and I still think I would have reacted the same way. It got a little out of hand. You know, it got way out of hand. We solved it real quick. We did what we did. We got split up. It was over. That's the way it should have stayed. But other people got involved, you know, other things happened, and it really got, you know, a little messy.
I hereby pledge to provide positive support.
These parents in Jupiter, Florida are taking the pledge to behave themselves at their children's games. It's part of the National Alliance for Youth Sports program that requires parents to attend a one-hour class on sports civility.
If your kid and you are not having fun, then you're really wasting some very precious time.
If parents think this is silly and don't show up, their kids cannot play in any of the town's leagues. Simple as that.
What do you think of this program?
I think it's a great idea. We've seen people last year where we've had to escort referees out because they've been threatened by other players or other parents, so it's a great thing to have.
Just about everyone we spoke to felt the same way. Make the parents promise to behave, and they will. Maybe because if they don't, their own kids will suffer. But listen to the horror stories about the way things used to be.
Coaches grabbing their kids if they missed the ball, choking them. And they're 5 and 6 year olds. They're not professionals.
He was ranting and raving, hollering and screaming, saying cuss words.
At
the kid, at the coach, at everybody. I mean, he was just going completely berserk.
One day we started looking out there at the kids, and the kids seemed so uptight, so unhappy.
The next morning, we went to Jupiter Community Park for a first-hand look at how the program is working. Pee-wee football for 8 to 10-year-olds. And for the most part, the parents on the Jupiter side of the field, while boisterous, were under control. But on the other side of the field...
Then you need to stay with me and act like you want to play this game.
I am.
No, you're not.
Yes.
And you're not. You're moping around going, how come I'm not getting to play?
This is the visiting team from another town up the Florida coast. On this side of the field, the atmosphere is a little more, well, let's call it intense.
Oh, I guess they got that one too, huh? Yeah, they'll get them all, I'm sure. Hey, what is that? Come on, guys. You're killing me. Red Jones can see this crap.
He's Robert Shepard, the in-your-face visiting team coach and parent of one of the football players, who seems to adhere to that old saying that dancing is a contact sport. Football, even peewee football, is more like nuclear war.
The intensity seemed awfully, at an awfully high level. Do they enjoy that, or do they, if they don't enjoy it, is it good for them?
They love it.
Give it for me. We love it.
It's not badminton. It's football. Right. You go out there not intense, you're going to get hurt.
We teach them discipline. We teach them teams. We teach them as there is no I in team, you know, the organization. It all rolls into their later as they grow up in life to realize this is the way things are built.
And the moment between you and the referee?
I was wrong. I got a little upset because I seen a few things at the referees. I realized they can't catch it all, but Ray Charles could have caught a couple of those plays.
These kids are trying to win a game and y'all ain't helping them none.
They don't need you to holler either, all right? Now that's enough.
How about some therapy?
Hey, come on, guys. How about some officiating here?
And to those who say it's too intense, there's too much emphasis on winning, and if they don't win, you know, what? They're losers and that type of thing.
No, when they don't win... you've also got to be able to build them up and get their confidence back up that they lost, but that doesn't mean that they're not worth what practicing. Everybody is going to incur some disappointment in any game.
Right.
As far as the toughness and how rough they are, if they don't want their kids to be tough and rough and play the game, they need to put them in gymnastics or ballet dancing.
We've lost our emotional maturity with children in sports.
What does that mean?
We don't know the moment to step back.
This month, Fred Eng's group is launching a nationwide campaign to require parents all over the country to take the pledge. It's the first step, he says, to stopping what he calls parent rage.
We want this program because we've seen enough. We've had it up to here. We don't want these dysfunctional people destroying what's going on. We don't want all of this behavior going on. We've had it.
Bernie, sad as it is, I guess we shouldn't be surprised at anything we saw in there because it's part of just a lessening of civility across the board in society.
Right. I mean, we have road rage in America. We have airport rage. Sooner or later, we're going to have something. Somebody's going to say there's cell phone rage when somebody's talking in the restaurant and gets hit over the head with his entree. So with all this kind of rage, it's almost, Bryant, a logical, perverse, but logical extension that we would have this parent rage at
youth
sports.
And this really isn't about kids.
No, I would argue that this isn't about kids at all. This is about grown-ups who, if we could use the cliche, ought to just get a life. The coaches sometimes think that they're coaching in the Rose Bowl or at the Super Bowl. They see it on television. They see big-time coaches in the face of big players, so they do it with little kids. It's the kids are just out there. The kids are out there trying to have fun, as a matter of fact. The coaches are out there fulfilling some, I think, some psychological need that they have.
And normally, these coaches, how closely are they screened?
Well, I mean, they're regular people, you know? I mean, they have regular jobs. 5 days a week, they act.
So it's basically whoever they can recruit to spend the time.
Yeah, I mean, if somebody shows an interest and they want to be a coach, you could probably be a coach.
Yeah. Final sad note, you were telling me about the insurance part of this. That's unbelievable.
Yeah. Insurance companies, it sounds strange, but it's true. Insurance companies are offering insurance specifically for officials of these sporting events because there have been so many assaults. And the number, by the way, is going up.
That's sad. Pathetic.
I'm going to get you tonight because you let me down, brother.
No, I'm not.
You did. I don't give what you do to me. You let me down. I don't care if you're going to play 100%. I'll get you, buddy. Cry about that.
What'd she do? She put did her job! Go home if you don't know how to play the game!
Hey! What is that? Come on, guys! You're killing me! Red Jones can see this crap!
Zach, what is your problem?
It's all right, buddy. It's all right.
Look at all this cool stuff you get to wear. I'll help you, okay?
It's going to be fun, big guy. Come on, bud.
One, two, three, four, five.
All right, you guys ready? And if I play well, my parents, if I play bad, don't say anything. And if I play well, it doesn't really matter if they compliment me on how I play. I just, like, I don't know, I prefer my parents to, I don't know, not talk as much.
I can hear them, like, cheering me on, and I'm, like, thinking in my head, just shut it, I'm trying to focus.
My mom yells in Spanish, like, go, go, go.
My mom usually says, use the backboard, you should use the backboard.
I get angry because it annoys me.
I'm kind of embarrassed.
She tells me to get in the position that my coach told me not to get in. I'm like, well, no. And then she's like, get in your position. I'm like, no.
I get a little tense when I have a certain score to get. And she's like, you've got to get that whatever score. And I'm like,
I don't like it when they try to push me even more, even though I'm trying really, really hard.
Coming from the coach's mouth, is kind of better, I feel like, because your parents are there to support you and your coach is there to help you, you know?
You start screaming, Valentina, run faster, make a basket. But I just start going slower every time when she says that.
The other people were like, wow, that mom is like really wanting her kid to win.
In my inside, you can't see it, but I'm inside saying, be quiet, be quiet, be quiet.
Sometimes I just look into space.
I try to listen to them and then do what they say to, like, so they don't start yelling again.
I don't really want them to give me that much advice because then I like forget it all.
Sometimes I get nervous.
When they yell and nobody else is yelling. Sometimes it can embarrass me. Like, a lot.
Wait. What's going on? We're just trying to do this, but you want us to try harder?
Well, I am.
I'm not going into a game not trying my hardest. That'd be, like, messed up.
Yeah, it's a lot of pressure. Sometimes when they try to get the ball in basketball, you kind of think in your head that they're kind of like gonna push you and you're gonna fall and hurt yourself.
They don't need to like always be like telling me what to do like every minute of the game. They kind of just gotta let me play.
I love when you say it like really nice. I got it, Mom.
I'd like to look back and I'd like to see you like smile or like give me a thumbs up.
Mom, I wish you would be a little bit quieter. Say like you play good and like you couldn't get them next time.
When they smile and say like good job.
Well, and Dad,
thank you for loving me.
I love
being my supporter.
When I'm upset, my mom and dad cheer me up.
Sometimes I forget about all the work that they do for me.
Be my biggest fan.
We need a lot of love. I want you to know
I need big hugs.
I love the snacks that you bring me. It makes me happy when you always encourage me.
Thank you, Mom and Dad.
Please just be my mom and dad.
Yep, that's it.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All. Call in at 702-470-7664 or Skype in. Username, Nonpartisan Liberty for All.
Nonpartisan Liberty for All, and we are back. I hope you enjoyed the clips there from, one was from HBO Sports, actually, and from some kids. There was one that the one where the father, I was going to comment during the clip, but it was like, he was like, I'm going to get you later or whatever. I think that was like the kid's dad, because I mean, these are YouTube videos that are just, I'm playing the audio of, and the dad like grabs him in the corner and he's like, I'm going to do this later and whatever. It was here. Oh, I don't have it turned up.
Because you let me down, brother.
No, I'm not.
That, like, where it's fucking scary, actually. So you have kids, I don't know, people that have seen Friday Night Lights, you have, in that movie, one of the fathers, he had gotten a ring, a state championship ring in Texas, and his son was playing football as well, and he, you know, was all on his son. He was an alcoholic too in the movie. I think it was actually based on a true story, but I don't know how much was for the, you know, dramatic effect and how much, you know, what was true and what wasn't. But I believe Friday Night Lights was based on some kind of true story of the team, and I guess the team the next year won the state championship, which must be a big thing in Texas. I don't know how they have it divided into divisions, you know, how many teams that play, but of course it's a huge state, so they probably have it, you know, divided, but whatever. They were, I guess they ended up being state champions the next year, but the father was all fucking mad when the son fumbled and he made fun of him and all this stuff. But I think in the end he apologized when he was sober or whatever. But the last kind of coach was an actual, I guess I would consider her an actual coach, not in the sense of a team, because they're not a team, but there was two twins who played tennis, and the mother was like their coach. And I don't know if she was thinking of, I believe she was, because she mentioned them, Venus and Serena Williams. She had two twin boys. She wanted them to be doubles champions. That was her dream there. But I guess they also played in singles tournaments, and they said that if they ever happen to, you know, if they both made it to the finals, they would just forfeit because they wouldn't play each other. But she mentioned Venus and Serena Williams, and she's like, I think they played each other once. I don't think they did, but they may have. But anyway, they were 11 or 12, and she kind of seemed like a flake who I couldn't tell, really didn't say if she had forced them into it, but they were at a point where I believe they were playing for a long time, you know, since they were little kids. And I don't think most kids now, I guess it's possible, but not many kids come to their parents at, like, you know, before maybe age 10 or at least age 8 and want to get into sports like that. Like, they may, I'm trying to think of the first age. I played T-ball, but that was like, you know, more of something you just go and play for fun. It's not, you know, they were learning to play tennis to be, you know, play in tournaments and be like professional tennis players, as opposed to, you know, playing in Little League and playing T-ball or something. So besides team sports, which, you know, you may have friends or they may, you may hear about it in school and play for fun. I don't think many kids want to get that serious on their own at that age. Maybe when they hit, you know, high school or junior high, or definitely high school, I think is when kids will get serious if they're talented and, you know, really get into the sport on their own. But with these parents, you know, pushing their kids, the other thing is that if they are successful, which most likely they won't be, I mean, the chances are very slim, but if they are successful, they're going to miss out on their childhood. And even if they aren't successful, they're missing out on a lot. And I think at that age, unless they somehow show some sort of desire to be in it. But like I said, I don't see a kid that young showing the desire to do that. I mean, I guess it's possible maybe one kid in, you know, I don't know how many. And most kids, they go through stages where they want to do something and then they quit anyway. Like, they want to go play this sport. And then it's like, okay, I don't want to do it anymore. I want to go, now I want to play an instrument. Now I want to do this. Now I want to do that. A lot of kids, I think, go through different stages throughout their childhood, and that's normal, and they try different things and they should have the opportunity to do that. So if you invest all your time in them playing one sport and then they're like, well, I don't want to fucking do this, it seems like these types of parents, at least in this tennis lady, that she would have forced her kids to continue, that they didn't have a choice. And that goes back to the whole peaceful parenting thing and your kids doing what they want to do. Now, I have to make a distinction here as well, because the first time I heard about peaceful parenting was Stefan Molyneux, and I'm pretty sure he's not the one who came up with it. And he's a guy who can really fucking piss me off. He's kind of like what I was saying earlier, in that if there's things that you don't disagree with me on, it doesn't mean that you have to necessarily get mad and not listen if there's a whole bunch of other stuff that you do. And I forgot about him, that I'll listen to him sometimes. But he pisses me off more than I like him, to be honest. But he does have some good information, which is good. And with that information, one of the things that he focuses on is peaceful parenting. And I think that's where I heard the term, peaceful parenting. But it seems like peaceful parenting is just about the not hitting and more of the talking and understanding, but he doesn't talk about not disciplining his kids. I think that's part of the, although it has unschooling in it, the radical unschooling types that don't discipline their kids as well. Like the lady we had on the show that I can't think of her name right now, but I will in a second because I have her on Skype somewhere. Dana Martin, who was on Wife Swap and a few other shows. She has some really good videos. She came off kind of, I don't know if it's just, if it was just me or it's like there was some arrogance there, but maybe it just sounded that way to me. But she was good on the show and she has a lot of good information. I don't agree with her necessarily on everything, but I do agree with her on a lot of things. And she just totally lets her kids do whatever they want, period. Even when it comes to school. So that's the radical unschooling part. I don't totally agree with radical unschooling because I think there's some things that your kids need to learn and that you as a person should have knowledge of. And, you know, things like math and how to, well, this is probably going to go away at some point, but, you know, balance a bank account or checkbook, things like that. And she basically, the radical unschooling is like 100% whatever the kid wants to do. And then you turn that into whatever they're doing, you kind of turn it into an education. And then they, as they get older, kind of educate, self-educate. So I think a little of that is good as far as looking at what their interests are and at the same time getting them to do some of the things that you'd like them to learn without forcing them to do it. And there's ways, I think, to do that. But Stefan Molyneux also talks about bargaining, which I don't particularly like. And that's just my ideas now. I mean, of course, I don't have kids at this point. I'm basing everything off of my experience as a kid as opposed to a parent. And I know there's a difference, but I know I vividly remember how I felt as a kid enough to know what I feel not to do. Now, again, people that have kids can totally disagree with me. And I know right away that there's people that would say, just like with other things, well, what if they did this? The what if question, which I love. What if? The funny thing is that people never say that about, well, what if the police started killing over 1,000 people a year. What would you do? Oh, they do that. I guess nothing. You know, things like that are not asked. It's like, because this is what pisses me off, actually, when it comes to looking at government and looking at different things and how you would handle them in a more freedom-oriented way, and then looking at things and how they are currently and not questioning how things are currently, because things are fucked up. And when they wrote the Constitution, they didn't have the answers to, I mean, if you look at it, obviously they didn't have the answers to the majority of things. How are they going to handle things? Well, they're going to figure that out, because the Constitution leaves the majority of things up to the states and then the federal government to pass additional laws, which unfortunately they went crazy with. But the same thing in parenting, it's, well, what if this happens or what if that happens? But you can say the same fucking thing. It's that what if question sometimes makes me want to fucking strangle people, because I could say what if on so many existing things. What if your government was $20 million in debt? $20 trillion in debt, and they couldn't manage the budget. What if the CIA just went around doing covert operations, killing people? What if the politicians used the military as their own personal fucking mercenaries? I mean, these are all things that are going on that nobody's, well, it would just, okay, but that's okay. But when I say anything, it's, well, who would build the roads? Like, that's the fucking most important thing that you're worried about or that you can come up with. I mean, it whatever, it's ridiculous. But the basis for peaceful parenting with the, I guess, radical unschooling part of it, and the, and I don't know that I'd go by those definitions, because I wouldn't want to do exactly what they're doing. Now, I definitely wouldn't want to hit my kids, and I definitely wouldn't push them into any sports. I would support them. So the looking at the sports issue that we've been talking about, so I would definitely support them in whatever they want to do sports wise. If they want to play sports, then that's fine. If they don't, then that's fine. I think, though, I would do the same thing that my father did, that if I had to pay for it, I don't know that it would be okay to quit. But then again, I don't want to force them to do something. So I'd make that deal with them. But then what if they wanted to quit? Would I actually force them to continue? I don't think so. But once that would happen, you know, I'd say the next time, well, I'm not paying the money for it, which means I'm not stopping them and telling them what they can do. I'm just saying I'm not paying for it. So, but I guess my philosophy when it comes to kids, at least as of now, now that, of course, can change, is similar to Dana Martin's philosophy, but not fully. And that's looking at it from a standpoint of, I'm not going to bring up obedient kids to be passed off to the government and the state to just not question things and not think for themselves. And I'm not going to punish them, because what is the point of punishment if you really look at it? So the point for some people is, okay, if I punish them, they'll be scared to do it again. So you're instilling fear in your kids because you're saying, okay, I'm going to punish them, and if I do, it will stop them from doing it again because they're scared of the ramifications, whether that be grounding them or hitting them or whatever. And I've already said, you know, if you're into peaceful parenting, you won't hit them. But how does, and I think he's against, although he's not against discipline, he's against punishment. But I don't know how he would discipline. I don't know. And talking about Stefan Molyneux. So I'm not sure how he would handle a situation where he felt that his daughter should be disciplined. But, you know, as far as things like, you have parents that will punish kids for quote unquote talking back or for interrupting you, or all that shit is bullshit, first of all, because, you know, disrespect, they'll call it, or I don't believe in punishing a kid for that anyway. I don't. They have the right. They're a human being. And we go back to that term that is one of the most important terms, is self-ownership. Now, most people think that if you're under 18, not most, but some people think if you're under 18, self-ownership doesn't matter. And that, to me, makes no sense, because 18 is just an arbitrary age that the government has come up with. But I think that any of that stuff, they have the right to speak. It reminds me of being in a fucking courtroom, is what it reminds me of. And I guess there was an article that somebody got found in contempt of court for not taking off a Black Lives Matter pin. Now, I don't support Black Lives Matter, but that is ridiculous. But it doesn't surprise me, because that's what the courts do. And people are not fucking getting this. So the way people are going to take this article, and I'm kind of going off on another tangent here, and then I'm going to wrap up, because I'm kind of going back to the stuff I talked about at the beginning regarding race. But the stuff that people are going to say is, they're going to look at, and this is why I'm frustrated with them when it comes to the police, because they're not looking at the where they should be looking. It's like they're pointing over here when people should be looking over there. But they're going to look at, oh, look, it's going to be about racism and the judge is racist. You can't even wear a Black Lives Matter pin. But what people aren't going to focus on is the real issue, that judges have too much power and they shouldn't be able to say shit about what you have on in court, or even the right to find you in contempt of court. That should not exist. The power a judge has is ridiculous. However, this is what fucking pisses me off about all of this shit. And this is why one of the reasons why, among others, just because I support everybody, I don't focus on race. Meaning that with police, with whatever, I focus on the oppression of people's freedom. And it could be all Black people that happen to be, it could be an issue that it's all Black people being oppressed, for example. Like the stop and frisk is a perfect example. My opinion was they should have got rid of stop and frisk. And this is where I have the fucking issue, and people are not understanding, and they're looking at it. And this is where bringing race into it and focusing on the racial part does not change anything. Because you had people that, instead of saying, get rid of stop and frisk, that would have solved the issue. That's what I wanted to do. black people mostly and Hispanic people, their rights in New York, which is a fucking might as well be, you know, a communist country at this point. But anyway, their rights were being oppressed. It didn't matter to me that it was all black people and Hispanic people. I don't give a fuck about what the race is of somebody. I don't have any allegiance to white people or any race. So, in this ridiculousness, and I don't know how serious he is or not, but I think he's pretty fucking serious. Like I mentioned the Cantwell earlier, who now says that, you know, white people need to be with white people to help preserve the white race, like some fucking, you know, and again, he claims he's not racist. And this is a guy who also claimed that I don't know if he still claims he is. He's a voluntarist or anarchist or whatever, and I don't like labels, but he definitely doesn't support freedom for all people. Although the fact that you believe that, as long as you don't think it should be illegal not to do that, technically does not interfere, or it doesn't, what's the word I'm looking for? You could still say that you believe in freedom, even if you have that opinion, because he's saying that personally, and that's what people should do, but he's not saying it should be illegal. So technically, he's not violating a principle of freedom in that statement, but I'm sure he does in other ones. He's basically a conservative neo-Nazi or something. But, yeah, I mean, it didn't matter to me the race of the people that were being oppressed. What mattered to me is you're fucking stopping people and frisking them. That's violating people's rights. So my thing was, end it. It's not that it matters. It's unconstitutional, but that's, you know, they try to get around it with this Terry stop thing. However, they don't even follow the Supreme Court decision on the Terry stop. Because if I'm referring to the correct stop, it was where you had to be, there had to be some suspicion in the stop. It wasn't just you could stop anybody because you felt like it. There had to be some suspicion. And in the court case, it was something like they had, it was late at night. They had long coats on that looked like they may have had tools to break in. Like it was that type of thing. So it wasn't a reasonable, enough for a reasonable suspicion, but there was still something that said, this is kind of suspicious. What they were doing in New York, it was just like you're walking down the street and they stop you and frisk you. So based on the constitutional decision, that would be unconstitutional. But of course, the government doesn't matter. It doesn't matter to the government. And this is what people don't get. Some of these people that, like I was talking about on YouTube earlier, it's like there's this big white conspiracy to rule the world or something. And, you know, there may be like 5% or 1%, it wouldn't even be 1% of the elite white people that have that conspiracy going. But it's about elite white people. It's not about any white person, if that's the case. But anyway, and it still oppresses white people and all people. Anyway, you had people basically that would have been okay with, yeah, our issue is just, you know, search more white people and we'll be okay. What kind of logic is that? And this is what I'm talking about. It's the same fucking thing with the police when it comes down to Black Lives Matter, and they just focus on the racist aspect of it. Because it doesn't get to the root of the problem. The root of the problem is not racism. I actually wouldn't even call it racism. I'd call it prejudice and discrimination, to be honest. I mean, I'm sure there's police that do have some hatred for Black people, especially that work in all Black neighborhoods. I'm sure there is. But I think the majority are, you know, I've said this before, they look at a lot of Black people as automatically they're criminals because they're Black. It's not necessarily that they hate them. And then they get scared and bang. And now they're, you know, of course, the way they're hiring police, or they're hiring police with lower IQs. They're hiring the guys out right out the army, the guys that watch the videos of breaking the doors down. I mean, those are the cops that they're hiring. I mean, one that arrested me for no reason and it was dropped 3 days later, the DA didn't even press charges, is an MMA guy. I can find the video and fucking post it. And he had no right to even ask me to get out of my car. I should have said no. But that's what happened to me the other time when I was asking, why are you asking me to get out of my car? And they dragged me out of my car. And of course, I was drunk, so I couldn't really do much except get dragged out of my car and get bruises all over me. And you can see those pictures at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. But what Black Lives Matter initially did, my issue with them, was they made it all about race, and it became, because of government media, all about the Mike Brown case as opposed to all these other cases that were going on of Black people as well that were so much more clearer, that were on tape, that people weren't getting outraged about those, but they did with this one. And that's what the media wanted and the government wanted, and because it divided people. I'm telling you, the whole thing from Trayvon Martin to fucking, and the coverage of that, to Michael Brown, and then they did cover a couple cases that were pretty obvious. But they still don't cover 98% or 99% of the fucking cases. You don't see on government media. So, unless somebody, you know, burns up a fucking building. And that's part of it, too. Why they covered the other cases. I think Mike Brown was the perfect case. I did a whole show on it, so if you want to go back and listen to it, to divide people and to get the government's plan going. But the government doesn't want the police to have less power or the police to be demeaned or blamed, or, you know, they want to just blame it on racism. So they focus on that. Nobody's talking about the police have too much power. We need to get rid of them because, and that doesn't mean that there's some kind of, even if there's still a government, some kind of replacement that doesn't have the power. But the police should no way exist the way they exist today with the amount of powers they have. They shouldn't be able to search your car. They shouldn't be able to do a lot of things. But people are already brainwashed, like, oh, my God, if they couldn't search your car, what would happen? They wouldn't find drugs that should be legal anyway. But that's initially was my issue with Black Lives Matter. I was fine. They wanted to protest. That's fine. And then their platform, of course, that was funded by a bunch of white people. And those bunch of white people have a political agenda, a progressive political agenda of socialism and communism and control. You can't sit there on one side and say, we want more freedom. We don't want the, from police at least, we don't want police fucking with us and harassing us anymore, but we want more laws. You can't have it both ways. They contradict, Black Lives Matter contradicts itself. Now, there are those people that just went out to the protest that they're like, hey, I'm going to protest the police killing somebody. And, you know, weren't necessarily a quote unquote member of Black Lives Matter. And that was fine. And again, I mean, it's fine to go out and protest and that they do that. But they have a whole different agenda. They're holding up signs with communist website addresses, like the revolutionary communists. And no one wants to say anything about some of this stuff because they don't want to be labeled racist. And, you know, I know who I am. The people that know me know who I am, and I'm definitely far from a fucking racist, okay? And I've experienced a lot of shit in my life as well. And to sit there and you have people, more millennials, who want to talk about things like white privilege, and I told you about the girl at the beginning of the show who had talked about she had put down black guys that date white girls and they should know better and white girls are evil and that it's white people's fault that black people don't have jobs. Basically, if a black person gets fired, it's because they're black. And it's all white people's fault of the unemployment rate, all this shit, that yes, there are some people that are racist that won't hire somebody that's black and that fire, may have fired somebody because they're black, but is it the majority of the people? Probably not. How often is it? I don't know. But racism does still exist. So it's definitely something that is possible. But at the same time, whatever happened to self-responsibility? And I look at that from the standpoint of there are plenty of successful black people that work their ass off because they had to work harder than a lot of white people in their same situation in a lot of cases. So if they can make it and a black person can become president and black people can have successful businesses and be basically, black people are everything that white people are when it comes to professions. So to say that it's like a third world country for black people is a distortion of the truth. Now, is it harder for your average black person to make it? Yeah, I believe it is, because there is still racism. In general, I believe it is. Now, if you come from families of privilege, and there's black people that come from families of privilege, I know some. But it's harder in general for everybody to make it now with the fucked up economy. But, you know, like I look at, it depends on your situation. I look at myself and everything I have, I had to work 10 times harder than the next person to get. And, you know, neither of my parents went to college. My father was in a cab business. I never lived in a house till I live in one now. We rent one. I bought a townhouse when I was 30 because, you know, totally on my own. But when I lived with my parents, we never lived in a house. We finally rented a duplex, which was a piece of shit. I mean, I never lived in poverty, so I don't want to say that. There are plenty of people who had it a lot worse than me. But at the same time, there are plenty of people who had it a lot better than me as well. And I also, you know, I have a bachelor's degree. I have a master's degree. Nobody helped support me. I got to live at my parents' house. That's about it. In the duplex, because they got that like a few years before I actually moved out. When I moved out, I had no safety net. I had no nothing. My parents didn't have any money. They couldn't help me out if I lost my job. So, you know, this whole, and I was always looked at, I always looked younger than I was. I was always looked at as some kind of, you know, punk kid. Nobody ever took me seriously. People had put me down at, you know, jobs behind my back and totally dismissed and ignored me. And I had to work hard to prove myself. And if it wasn't for my working hard, and not to be arrogant, but my intelligence, I wouldn't be anywhere. Even with the fucking degrees. That didn't mean anything. I didn't know anybody. I didn't have parents that knew people like that could get me jobs. And I'm not sitting here, you know, feeling bad for myself or trying to give myself credit neither. All I'm doing is giving an example, because of course I know the example of myself better than anybody else. You know, I grew up fighting people, getting jumped, shit like that. And, you know, I didn't live in the ghetto. I didn't live somewhere where I was getting shot at or anything like that, but I was somewhere where people fought all the time. You know, I was shy. When I was younger, I got picked on and stuff like that, like elementary school and junior high and then even high school, you know, to an extent. And then, you know, people started being scared of my friends. But it's like, you can't just judge somebody and say, well, you're part of, your skin is this color. And, you know, I could probably pass for half Hispanic or something, but your skin is this color, so that means this. No. In any sense. And you can't look at somebody black and say that, you know, not every black person lives in the fucking ghetto. They want you. That's all they show on TV, though. On the fucking news, when they interview people, they don't interview intelligent black people on the news. They want you to think all black people are stupid and live in the ghetto and are poor. It's not the reality. And yes, there is racism. Or discrimination. I would call it more discrimination because I'm thinking of jobs. But then what do you do about it? So you have people who have the right of free association or of they can feel how they want. And if they want to express it on a radio show, they can do that too. There's like the Nazi fucking radio shows, just like there's the black nationalist radio shows where they say a whole bunch of shit about white people. And I told you about YouTube videos where I was just saying the girl that totally badmouthed white girls that date black guys and thinks that black people should totally segregate. Now, who the fuck is she, though, and she has the right to say this, to speak for all black people? Just like, you know, any white person speaking for all white people or any, it's just ridiculous. People are individuals. We're all individuals. We all have individual stories and individual challenges. And we all went through things to get to where we are. Now, some people just were handed stuff and came from a life of privilege. That's true. But just being a certain race does not give you anything. I don't give a fuck what anybody says. And you could say whatever you want about me. But it's bullshit. And the reason why I say that the majority of it is government, and I'll explain that briefly and we'll end the show. Because number one, government has the most amount of power. We all know that. And somebody tried to say that we're the people are the government. And no, they're not. The government is an elite corporation, and that's a whole nother show. And I will probably end up doing a fucking show on that again to explain how the government is an elite corporation and how we, the people, are not the fucking government. Because it's not too hard to understand. That's just a ridiculous fucking statement I heard today. And I've heard before. That's what they say. The people are the government. Maybe 150 years ago. Not today. So, basically, and I totally lost my train of thought in switching on that about the people in the government, but regarding racism and people being discriminated against and all of that, when it comes down to it, everybody has, even though it's harder now, but everybody does have an opportunity to make something of themselves. It's getting less and less. It really is, because government is fucking everything up and taking over and eliminating small businesses by, you know, passing all these laws and making it harder to create your own business and all of this stuff. But the bottom line is that anybody can be successful of any race. It may be harder, but anybody can be successful of any race. And I know what I was going to say is that the reason why I say that the government is more, when it comes to racism, the government is the main problem. That doesn't mean there are other problems, is because the government has the most power, as I was saying. They have an injustice system, and that's what it is, that is discriminatory. They have the police that are, of course, discriminate, prejudice, racist, whatever you want to call them. And they have the power to fuck up your life based off of that. So the power of the government, if you could run into racist police or racist judges, they can totally fuck up your life. Now, the average person pretty much can't do shit. The average racist person. Now, if they're a business owner, maybe they might not hire you. Your people will run into people that own businesses that are racist. I don't believe it's the majority, but that will happen. But most corporations are scared of getting sued. So when it comes to corporations, it's not. You can run into racist managers and stuff like that or whatever, but there are laws, a bunch of them, and ways that you could file lawsuits and stuff like that and complaints. So it's not like that doesn't exist. People want to act like that doesn't exist neither. So there are options if you run into people that discriminate against you. But the power really that can affect your life is with the government. Because the average person isn't going to do shit except maybe not hang out with black people or maybe do a racist radio show like people I've mentioned, or, you know, at worst say something racist. And then in that case, you know, to me, you kind of got the right to knock them the fuck out. I wouldn't waste my time. But in the big scheme of things, compared to how it was 50 years ago in certain places, I mean, there's no comparison. There's really not. But that doesn't mean that there's still not a challenge to be successful for a lot of black people. But the point is that even though it may be a lot of hard work and you may have to work a lot harder than other people that have things handed to them, or, you know, are grow up privileged or whatever, if you want to make it, you can make it. And there's tons of examples of that. So people want to act like, you know, a race of people are treated like we're in a third world people or something like that. It's not the case. And it can't be the case, because if it was, there'd be nobody black in government. There'd be no black police. There'd be no, you know, all of these things. And I'm not saying these people didn't work hard to get to where they are, some of them. I think Obama was, his mom was CIA, so I think he was kind of groomed through the CIA, you know, since he was young or whatever. But I think so was Clinton, because supposedly in college he was approached by the CIA. I don't know. I had a friend who was approached by the CIA and interviewed with them, so right from college. So that shit does happen. So I didn't want to totally change the subject there. It's just a lot of stuff had come up today, and I listened to some YouTube videos today, so I wanted to comment on those. And the bottom line for me, again, is that I just want everybody to have the freedom to live their own lives. as long as they don't directly interfere with anybody else's. And that's it. And of all races. And if I see any oppression of anybody, of any issue, no matter if it's affecting just black people or just white people or just whoever, I will stand up for that. If the freedom of speech of fucking Nazis is being oppressed, as much as they disgust me, you know, I would still stand up for their freedom of speech. It's that same thing. You know, you either believe in those principles or you don't. So, you know, I hope that people really look at things without blinders on and try to look at them realistically and not just based on emotion or an experience. I mean, I could sit and base things off experiences and be racist over it or something like that. To actually white people as well. Like I was saying when, you know, growing up that I hung around with all the black kids and all the stuff they said to me. So, you know, I don't do that because I don't look at myself as any race. I know people say that, but I really don't. I look at myself as a person that wants freedom for everybody to choose how to live their own lives. I just want to be left the fuck alone, to be honest. And that's it. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm my own race. I'm in my own little world. And I wouldn't want to be anybody else. You know, I was born who I was, literally born. And, you know, I wouldn't want to be anybody else. But at the same time, I don't have some kind of you know, connection with white people or something that I don't have with other races. To me, we're all human beings. And I know that's a cliche, but that's really how I feel about it. So, well, we've gone over quite a bit. So I just wanted to, again, kind of clear up what I started talking about in the beginning. And not change the subject. Although, just so people know, I mean, I have my main topic, but that doesn't mean that there aren't other things that will come up on the show. I mean, it's a radio show. And some people don't understand that neither. I remember I got a message about, oh, it was 10 minutes until you started talking about this topic. And that was pretty fast because sometimes I'll go like an hour until I get to the main topic. So being that, you know, I want to have a topic to focus on and I want to have, you know, let people know, hey, I'm going to talk about this. That's the main topic. It may take the whole show or it may not, but there's, you know, other things that we may end up talking about. Although the next 2 days, we're pretty much going to be focused on our topic, and that's the Iran-Contra and MENA, Arkansas, which is all connected, where the CIA was involved in selling drugs, as was George W. Bush, Clinton, the Reagan administration. So it's going to be a two-part special, because I think it will take 2 days to talk about all the aspects of it. If people remember in the 80s, they had hearings with Oliver North and Ronald Reagan saying he had no recollection of anything, which he's full of shit. And then Gary Webb, who they made the movie Kill the Messenger about, did a story on it in 96. But I don't think he talked anything about Barry Seal. And we'll get into him a lot because he was the guy who worked for the CIA at the same time he flew in cocaine for the CIA. So the CIA not only needed money for the Contras, they needed money for themselves as well. And a lot of people made a lot of money off of that. So it from the information I'm getting, Bill Clinton was laundering money and getting some of that money as well. So we will be talking about that the next 2 days. So be sure to tune in for that. And as I mentioned, we're 24/7 now. So we will be going to shows of Nonpartisan Liberty for All from the past, I think they're mostly from last year. But we're nonstop 24/7 now. Nonpartisan Liberty for All Media and Radio Network. Be sure to check us out at nonpartisanlibertyforall.com. Again, I'd like to thank everybody for tuning in. I really appreciate anybody taking the time to listen to me for more than an hour, which it's at least 2 hours. And tonight it was 2 hours and 40 minutes. So thanks, everybody. And hopefully you tune in tomorrow because I think it will be a pretty good next 2 days and a lot of information that you're probably not even aware of with Arkansas and the MENA airport and Barry Seal and that whole thing. So thanks, everybody. Have a good night.
Comply with the police officer the way the system was meant to be. Comply with the orders of police officers. Resisting arrest is a real and dangerous crime.